classes. Today's session today, what are the topics we are going to discuss today is that today we are going to discuss about boundary conditions, and we are going to discuss about okay, so today we are going to okay, today we are going to discuss about what are the boundary conditions are there. Then we are going to discuss about what are the Pascal triangles, what is the use of that. Then we are going to discuss about today one more last topic is isoparametric, subparametric, and superparametric element. So that means we are going to wind up the topics today after module one theory part. So let me take the quickly what are the boundary conditions. See, boundary condition is a very important point we are going to use in an entire FEM, very important factor. That's why you should know first what are the types of is there. So based on the application, they are going to classify boundary conditions for for structural problems, or it may be non-structural problem. So like structural problem is when it is, as I told already, when it is subjected to a loads like shear load, bending load, torsion load. Non-structural problem is when it's subject to thermal load, or it may be fluid load. Those things are different types of analysis there. Therefore, the different kind of these the boundary condition are different. Let me take the first one for structural problem. In FEM, after assembling the individual stiffness matrix load vector, we can get an equation. This equation cannot be solved for unknown values, since overall characteristic matrix will be singular, whose determinant value will be zero, and inverse will not be exist. In case of solid and structural mechanics problem, the structural system is unstable under applied load. The structure is free to undergo unlimited rigid body motion unless some support or boundary conditions are imposed to keep the structure in equilibrium or stable under the applied load. Hence, hereby the some boundary condition are to be applied for the system equation before solving the unknown. So as we discussed in the steps involved in that, after assembling the global stiffness matrix, we need to apply the boundary condition. So that boundary conditions, why you need to apply means what are the knowns are there that going to be eliminate, what is the unknowns are there that only we are going to solve. So therefore, that is very important. So therefore, boundary condition in case of structural, there are two types will be there. One is homogeneous boundary condition, one is non-homogeneous boundary conditions. What do you mean by homogeneous boundary condition? Means homogeneous boundary condition occurs at location that are completely prevented from the movement. Means where the nodes are there, which is completely it is going to be fixed, it the movement are going to be resist, then that is the that type of boundary condition is known as a homogeneous boundary condition. Let us take a example. So take a example here, take an example here. Now this is the beam, and it is free at both ends. Here the displacement is v and y direction, and x direction is it is u. So therefore, the boundary conditions never be exist here. Why? Because here it is not fixed. So therefore, homogeneous means one location, one node must be completely fixed or resist the movement. Completely, it is going to be zero in displacement. So suppose you take an example here. It is fixed here at which point or A node. Whereas in case of B, it is not fixed. It is a displacement u. Therefore, at A, the displacement u also zero. And v also zero, because here it is completely fixed here, so therefore there is no displacement at A point. But when case of B, only displacement along y x direction is there, but not y direction. Come to the third one. So here you can see, and also dv by dx also zero here. That means the rate of change of displacement, the change of the displacement with respect to the x axis, dv by dx also zero. Why? Because it is fixed. Come to the third one. Here, it is fixed support they given. Here, roller support they given. Therefore, on which direction displacement will be there? On which direction at point A, displacement will be there? A or B? Sorry, along X or Y? Because of roller support is fixed here, on which direction your roller support will displacement take place at point A, either X direction or Y direction?
X direction.
So only X direction is there, that's not equal to zero, but Y direction there is no displacement, that's why V equal to zero. But there is a dV by dx will be there, dV by the rate of change of displacement V with respect to X, because it's going to move, no? Therefore, that is not equal to zero. So this type of boundary condition is known as homogeneous type, means any one direction the node is going to be constrained. That is what, completely constrained. So non-homogeneous means, non-homogeneous boundary conditions occurs when finite non-zero values are specified, such as settlement for a support. Example, you can see here, non-homogeneous boundary conditions occurs when finite non-zero values are specified. Finite non-zero values are specified means already they specify some displacement in the structure itself. Take an example of this bar element, stepped bar. You can see A, B, C. At A, it is fixed. But C is not fixed and B also not fixed. But there is already given some displacement, finite number of displacement already given. Therefore, what happened? At end A, along X direction, U is definitely, it can't able to move the point A, it should not move, it can't able to move along the X direction. Therefore, U tends to 0 at point A, whereas at point C, U tends to what? Delta. Because this much gap is there, definitely when you're going to apply the force, C can easily move with respect to the X direction up to the distance delta. After that, it cannot be moved because there is a constraint is imposed. Suppose you take an example of truss element. See, A, B, C are the point which is displacement. After it is displaced, you can see in the dashed line, it is A point is displaced up to the height of delta. Along which direction? Y direction. Therefore, at point A, U direction, the displacement is zero. Displacement where zero. Whereas, along Y direction, the V displacement is how much? The V displacement is how much? V is
delta.
Along the Y direction is delta. Whereas, comes to point B. B, it is having roller support. At point A, it is having fixed support. It is having roller support here. Therefore, the U is not equal to zero will be there. And also, because it can be moved easily in the X direction, but in Y direction, what happened? It is constrained. Therefore, V equal to zero. So this type of boundary condition is known as non-homogeneous boundary conditions. So that means finite non-zero values are specified because here delta is specified already. That type of boundary condition is known as non-zero. That is in case of structural problem. Let me take the non-structural problem like heat transfer problem or fluid flow problem. Let me take first in that heat transfer problem. So in heat transfer problem means we have boundary conditions are specified like what is the temperature, what is heat flux, and how much convection, radiation, that they are going to mention here at the discrete point. Let me take up the first one, temperature for a 2D condition. See, you can see this is the body with respect to X and Y, two-dimensional body. At this left end, they mention the temperature as T naught. At this end, they mention the temperature as T1. And here, ambient temperature T0. Therefore, what is the boundary condition become here? When X tends to 0, when X tends to 0 means here, T tends to T0. T tends to T0. When X tends to L means here. What is T tends to? What is T tends to? When X tends to L, what is the temperature here? What is the temperature here? Hello?
TL.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
TL. That is temperature is TL here. Yes. So this is called as imposed temperature boundary condition. Suppose if you impose the heat flux boundary condition, you can take a body here. So not here, the here. Imposed heat flux means the heat flow rate into or out of in a body specified while distinctly possible in a mathematical sense. This type of boundary condition is not often encoded in practice. Means how much it flows, heat flux is entering into the system, flowing into the system or out from the system, they are going to mention. But usually this type of boundary condition is not going to practically use. Usually going to use this imposed boundary temperature and imposed convection. So let me see how the convection boundary condition they are going to impose. Again, take the body here. It is completely insulated. If it is insulated, therefore the convection is not going to be happened. Therefore, heat transfer is zero here completely. In case of here, they are shown that convection, it is H0. That is convective factor will be there. So therefore, when x tends to zero, what is q tends to? When x tends to zero, what is q tends to?
Zero, sir.
Zero, right? Similarly, when x tends to L, the q tends to, we know that formula, how to calculate the heat transfer due to convection, q into delta T. Sorry, q is equal to h into delta T. H means convection factor. H into difference in temperature, that is Ti minus T infinity will be there. So that is the boundary condition in case of convective. Usually only convective and temperature boundary condition are imposed, whereas second one is there, no, that is not much going to impose. Next one, fluid flow problems, how that define the boundary condition. For that, they are going to define like velocity with respect to velocity function phi. Suppose vx is the velocity along y x direction and vy is the velocity along y direction. So vx is equal to dou phi by dou x, where phi is known as velocity function, potential function, and vy is the dou phi by dou y. When you are going to do the fluid flow problem on model number 5, you can get know this. Similarly, where Vx and Vr, the velocity in x and y direction will be there. So you can see that figure they are showing. Suppose the body is fixed here, and here along x and y, they are going to mention the velocity Vx and Vr are there. So this is about the things called as boundary condition with respect to the fluid flow problems, boundary condition with respect to the heat flow problem, and boundary condition with respect to the structural problem. So these are the three types of boundary condition. In structural problem, there are two types, homogeneous and non-homogeneous. Homogeneous is any, the location of the node is, one location of the node is completely prevented from the movement. Non-homogeneous means already they have specified some displacement or non-zero displacement value. So that is known as non-homogeneous boundary conditions are there. So these are the types of boundary conditions. Okay. Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, we are going to, next one, we are going to discuss very important topic with a point of examination also, Pascal's triangle. See, Pascal triangle, what do you mean the Pascal triangle? Usually they will ask you the question, what is geometry isotropy or geometry invariance, and write a note on the Pascal's triangle. That's why you're taking first one. Before going to discuss the Pascal triangle, you should know first what is geometric invariance. Geometric invariance or geometric isotropy. ISO means what? Can you tell me what is ISO? Isotropic process, isotropic property. ISO means what? ISO. Same. Are you constant? Yes. So, geometric invariance. What do you mean by invariance? Invariance. What do you mean the invariance word? Meaning? What is invariance? There is values?
There is no difference, no changes.
Yes, exactly. Variance, invariance are the opposite word. See, beside the convergence and compatible requirement, one of the important consideration in the choosing the proper terms of polynomial expansion is that element should have no preferred direction. Element should have no preferred direction. When you're choosing the polynomial function, no, it should satisfy the convergence and compatible condition. Not only that, it should also, one more time, is element should have no preferred direction. That means that the displacement shapes will not change with when changing the local coordinate system. Suppose if we change the local coordinate system, the displacement shape means the element shape will not going to be changed. It will be constant. Even if you change the local coordinate system or if you change the Cartesian or natural, it will not change the shape of the element. And that property is known as geometric isotropy or geometric invariance. Means even if you change the coordinate system, the shape of the geometry will not going to change. That's why it's called invariance or isotropy, geometric isotropy of the element. So therefore, that is called geometric invariance or geometric isotropy. Geometric invariance means selected interpolation model that already explained. Element displacement pattern or shape will not change with respect to the local coordinate system. Now, using this property, we are going to express the polynomial function in a geometric form or geometric shape, that is triangle shape, that is known as Pascal's triangle. That is, it may be 2D form or 2D form, 3D or 2D. So this is for selected order of the polynomial interpolation model. The element displacement variation should be independent of local coordinate system. The geometric invariance, also known as geometric isotropy, already said that, or it is also one more known called spatial isotropy. This can be achieved if the polynomial is balanced in case of all term cannot be completed. This balanced representation can be achieved with the help of Pascal triangle. Means all the terms what we are using, a1, a1x, a2x, a3x, like that term should be balanced. And then only it will be geometric invariance can be achieved in the polynomial function. That can be achieved with the help of triangle. That is known as Pascal triangle. So let me see. That's why the Pascal triangle is a balanced graphical representation of polynomial interpolation model or displacement function. Therefore, Pascal triangle is the graphical representation of the polynomial function or interpolation function. Let me see for 2D and 3D case how this is going to be represented in a graphical way. You can take in, see the triangle. This is known as Pascal triangle because it's in a triangle shape, that to 2D. Why it is called 2D means you can see only XY terms are there, not Z terms. See, here, this law. See, here. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm discussing about this topic. Okay. Pascal triangle. Pascal triangle. No. Okay. See, in 2D Pascal triangle. In 2D Pascal triangle. This edges, left and right edges are same constants will be there. That means that same order will be there. One is left represent the x1 and right represent the y. You can see it start from 1, that is constant, x to the power of 1, x to the power of 2, x to the power of 3, up to x to the power of 4. Fourth order up to. Similarly, along this set, y to the power of 1, y to the power of 2, y to the power of 3. So order of polynomial same on either side, but this is with respect to x, this is with respect to y. Now, horizontally, if you measure, horizontally, if you take the term, that will represent constant n equal to 1, n equal to 2, n equal to 3, n equal to 4, and n equal to 5 will be there. So that is constant term, linear term, quadratic term, cubic term, and fourth order term. That is, fourth order means that n equal to 5 will be there. Now, how we are going to represent this means, you can see, suppose, linear term. Linear term. So here, the number of terms are 2 here, x and y. You can see. So linear term means n equal to how much it should be there? N equal to how much? Linear term, n equal to how much?
1, sir.
Linear.
2, sir. 2.
Linear, quadratic, cubic. Okay. Number of terms. Now, what I'm talking about here, n equal to value, how much will be there? We discussed here, no? Somewhere. Where is that? Here. Yeah. Yeah. Linear means n equal to how much? N equal to 1. Quadratic means n equal to 2. Cubic means n equal to 3. This is very important. So that we are going to representing here now. See here. Here, what is there? X to the power of 1 will be there. But here, y term not there. Why not written y term means that here y term is 0. So therefore, what is represent? Y terms, y to the power of 0 means what? Y to the power of 0 means what? It is 1. Correct, no?
1.
It is x. That is why it is x. Next. And one more thing, very important. I will take up this before that. Yeah. See, in a linear term, for two-dimensional case, what you should want? You should need the polynomial function like this, a naught plus a1x plus a2y. You have to get like that. So let me see how we will get here. See, that's why here they are not written y, because y to the power of 0 is there. Similarly, here x to the power of 0 and y to the power of 1, that is equal to y. That is equal to y. That's why written here. Now I want linear term. Linear term means like this. You can take a horizontally, you add it. So here, first one, a naught, because it is a constant term here. Come to the second one. Up to here, you'll get the linear term. So plus a1x plus a2y here. So this is known as linear term. We got it. Now, if you want quadratic, then what you have to add? No, you have to add from the top one to up to here. Add first one, a naught. Plus, what is next one? A1 into what? A1 into what?
X.
X square.
A2 into what? First X. Add one by line, horizontal line, one by one, add it. A2 into what? Y. Plus, A3 into what? Next third one you come. A3 into what?
X square.
Next. A4. A4 into what?
XY.
Next plus A5 into Y square. So like that you'll get the quadratic term. Can you observe here now? This is what we got. In a quadratic, where is the two-dimension form? This one, no? Hello? This is the two-dimensional quadratic form. Polynomial function that we got it in a, we can easily get it by using this Pascal triangle in a graphical representation. Now, can you tell me for cubic, how will get, what you have to do for cubic? Hello? For cubic, what you have to do? For cubic, what you have to do? You have to add which line?
All the three lines, sir.
Up to cubic term, this up to here you have to add it. This line,
yes, sir.
This line, and this line. So start from live. Let us take a naught and it is 1. Plus, next, what is that? A2x. Next, A3. I'm not able to write properly using a mouse. That is a problem. Why? Next, third line. A4 what? X square. Correct?
No, sir. A5,
X, XY.
A0 plus A1X, no, sir.
A1, correct. This is A1. A1X plus A2Y plus A3X square plus A4XY plus A5Y square plus A7X square Y plus A8XY square plus A9Y cube. Like that, you get the cubic term for the three-dimensional case. Let me see. Correct, no? Here. Cubic model for the two-dimensional case you got like this. For a cubic model, for a two-dimensional case, you get like this up to A9 term. Correct, no?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes,
like
sir.
That?
Yes, sir.
You can get it. For two-dimensional case, any order of the column if you want, you can represent in a graphical representation in a form of a triangle. That is known as Pascal triangle. So this is known as geometric invariance. When it is having geometric invariance, it can be used. Suppose in case of 3D. 3D means what is the one more term we are going to introduce? Z. See, you can observe in the 3D, 2D triangle. This line is there, no? It is same thing like this one. This one, this one, this one, this. Same thing. See, constant. X, Y is there. Here also X, Y. Here X square, Y square, X, Y, Y square. Same thing. Next, here x cube, x square, y square, y cube, same thing. Ready? So the first one cubic, the constant, then linear, quadratic, then cubic. But what is the one more term here is, because of three dimension, we are going to take not only x, y, one more is z. Therefore, first this left head represent the x, this right head represent the y, and this middle one, it represents Z. Here, 1, X, X square, X cube. Here, 1, Y, Y square, Y cube. Like that, here, Z, Z square, Z cube. So, who is that? Mute yourself. Who is that? Mute yourself. Hello. Hey, who is that? That fellow watching the TV, stupid fellow. This is what happens if you are logging also. We thought to know the you are listening, but not listening. Can you hear me? All of you alert? You're there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. See, I will repeat once again. See, in the three-dimension case, left one represent x, 1, x, x square, x cube, and right hand side 1, y square, y cube, and this line represents z, z square, z cube. So now, in between that, come to the quadratic, in between that, x square and z square and x square, here xz will be there, and y square, yz will be there. And between x and y, it is xy will be there. Similarly, come to here, third one. So in between this x cube and z cube, x square z, x z square will be there. In between y cube and z cube, here they represent with a z square y, z y square. And in between this x cube and y cube, x square y and x y square. So where all this point connected here, this is called xyz. Now, if I add it same thing for linear term, if you want a0 plus a1x plus a2y plus a3z. Suppose if you want quadratic form or this one a0 plus, you have to add all the three triangles, a0 plus a1x plus a2z plus a3y plus a4x square plus a5xz plus a6z square plus a7yz plus a8y square plus axy, like that you will get. So this is in a three dimension case, that is this one. See, that is three dimension case. No, you can get the this functions. For a linear model you'll get this one, for a quadratic model you'll get this one, and similarly for a cubic model you'll get this one. Got it,
sir?
Hello,
coefficients interchange adre problem agutha sir?
No, coefficients also no problem, because that is a constant. That if coefficients interchange also no problem, don't worry.
Okay sir.
Okay, because that is a constant sum. That is not, if you change also, instead of a1x I can take a2y also, no problem. A1x or a2x if you take it also, no problem. So like that. So this represent the polynomial function in a graphical way, and that is known as Pascal triangle for 2D and 3D. Is it clear, all of you? Is it clear? All of, is it clear?
Yes sir.
Yes sir.
Yes sir.
Last topic on this module, that means that is theory part I'm talking about, numerical part I said. See what we are covering the now, what is the covering your syllabus now? It is 70% of the first module we are going to cover. Remaining 30%, it is the numerical part of Rayleigh-Ridge method, Kallocky method will be there. That will take up at the end of the module, all the five module. I told only 70% we are covering the module one theory part. Got it? Okay. So this is usually one of the question they will ask you, like theory questions or basic concept. What do you mean by isoparametric elements, and what are the types? What do you mean by isoparametric, subparametric, and superparametric? That is the things we are there asking usually. So let me take what is isoparametric element concept first. Listen carefully, all of you. Suppose if I want to divide this circle in a straight edge, you can see, you can divide like this. Suppose if I discretize this same circle into number of pieces with a curved shape. With a curved shape. So what is the, which is the most accurate result it will give? When you are dividing into straight edge, or when you are going to divide into curved?
Straight edge.
Straight edge.
Is it? Which is having more number of elements? Suppose I need to cover entire. Which is having more number of elements? This one or this one? See, when you divide the elements in a straight edges, it will take more number of elements to get accurate result. Why? Because, and it will not give the accurate result compared to this curved path. You can, why? Because you can observe here. I will highlight something. You will observe carefully. See, when you divide this circle into number of straight edge, no, there is a some gap is there. This boundaries. Our curve is not captured. There is a void. Correct? No? Here. So that means it's not captured the actual geometry properly. But you can use, when I discretize this into like a curved shapes or curved curve, when you're using discretize into curve element, you can see it will capture the entire boundary properly with a minimum number of elements. Therefore, so this will give the accurate result than the straight edge. Understanding what I'm saying? All of you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. Sir.
So that means that,
yes, sir,
when the element is discretized with a curves, and that type of element is known as which element? That type of element is known as which element? Is known as isoparametric elements. Isoparametric element is nothing but curved shape of elements. which therefore it will capture the entire domain properly, all the boundaries it will properly, therefore it will give accurate result compared to the other. And if you want to capture this also, no, using a linear only, then you have to divide into number of small pieces, small element, then it will take more computation time, because more the degree of freedom it will be introduced, more the nodes will be introduced, therefore it will take more number of computation time. But with using this type of curve shape of element, it will be minimum number you can capture the entire boundary properly, therefore minimum time you get the accurate result. That is the advantage. So that is known as isoparametric elements. Is it clear? Clear?
Yes, sir.
What are the types will be there? So like you can see, this is 3-noded bar element, and this is 6-noded triangular element. You can see triangle is like a curve shape. And this is 8-noded quadratic element. This is 9-noded quadratic element. And this is the 20-noded hexahedral element. So the first one is for 1D. And these three are 2D elements. And finally, this one has 3D. Are you getting? So this is 3D element. Hello?
Yes, sir.
You can observe the boundaries of each element. It is curve shape. That's why it is called isoparametric elements. So this isoparametric elements variable going to be represent. Suppose you take a 2D form, 2D elements, 2D isoparametric element, the variation going to be represent, the variables going to be represent along with the X and Y direction. The variables means there are two types. Keep this in mind. One is known as geometric variable. One is known as field variables. So suppose if you want to represent a geometric variable, means that is X is equal to, suppose with respect to this element, N1 X1 plus N2 X2 plus N3 X3 plus N4 X4 plus N5 X5 plus N6 X6, because total number of nodes are 6 here. So where N1, N2, N3 are called as shape function. Shape. So what is shape function? Next module we are going to discuss shape function. X1, X2 are the corresponding nodal displacement at X, node 1, node 2 up to 6. Similarly, geometric, total geometric variables along the y direction is N1, Y1, N2, Y2, N3, Y3, N4, Y4, N5, Y5, N6, Y6. Then next one is called as field variables. Geometric variable means what is the variation of with respect to the geometric, means distance. Suppose if you take with respect to the X1, node 1 up from the X coordinate, how much distance will be there? Like this is called Y1 will be there. And from node 1 with respect to Y, what is the distance? That is X1 will be there. So that will represent the geometric variation. Field variable means that will represent the displacement variables along X and Y. The displacement along X is U, along V, Y is V. So therefore, the total displacement along X direction is N1 U1 plus N2 U2 plus N3 U3 plus N4 U4 up to N6. Similarly, what is the total displacement of the nodes along Y direction is N1 V1, N2 V2 plus N3 V3, N4 V4. And N5, V5, and N6, V6. So this is the two variable going to be represent for an isometric element. One is geometric variables and one is field variables. Usually geometric variables are the measure the distance of the nodes with respect to XY along X direction and Y coordinate. Field variables usually represent the displacement of the nodes along X and Y, that is U and V in case of 2D. We're talking about. In case of 3D, Z will comes and W will come. Are you getting? Are you understanding what I'm saying? Concept. All of you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So this is about called isoparametric element. Then, what is the difference between isoparametric, subparametric, and superparametric element? You can observe here in isoparametric element, how many number of geometric variables we taken in a particular direction, same number of field variables will be there on the other two direction also. That means here up to 6. Here also up to 6 will be there, both. Here up to 6. So that means isoparametric elements having equal number of geometry. How many number of geometries they know? The same number of field variables also there. Like at the each node, you can see in the dark circle represent the node geometry, and empty circle represent the field variable. That is this one, geometric variable, field variables. So therefore here one is missing actually. Here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 8 number of geometric variable and 8 number of field variables are there. That is nothing but displacement function. So that element is known as isoparametric element. What is subparametric means? Which one is more? Geometry variables is more or field variables is more? Can you count it and tell me? See, geometric variable represent in a dark circle. Field variable represent in a empty circle. Which is more? Geometric variables is more or field variables is more? Field variables is more. How many are there? Here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 are there. How many geometric variables are there? Only 4. So therefore, if the element contains more number of field variables compared to the geometric variable, and that element is known as subparametric element. That element is known as subparametric element. What do you mean by superparametric means? Here, tell me which variables is more, geometric variables or field variables is more? Which variables is more? Geometry. Correct? How many geometry variables are here? Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. How many field variables? Only 4. Therefore, if the element contains more number of geometric element compared to the field variable, and that type of element known as superparametric. Got it? So this one, isoparametric means, iso means same. That's why equal. Equal number of geometric variable, equal number of field variable. Subparametric means field variables more than the geometric. Superparametric means geometric variables is more compared to the field variables. What are those geometric field variables and field variables means? These are geometric variables that represent the displacement, means a portion of the node with respect to x and y coordinate. Field variable represent the displacement with respect to x and y. So that is about that. So this complete the topic of the concept of isoparametric, superparametric and subparametric elements. Clear?
Yes, sir.
So this completed the topic of, that is, basics of FEM in a module 1, except numerical part. That will take up the end.
Yes, sir.
Got it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So let me see some of the previous year question paper. What are the questions came under this module? Theory questions. You can see here. First one. Explain the steps involved in the FEM. Discuss the convergence and compatibility requirements of the element. See, this is one more. Explain the importance of node numbering scheme. Or what are simple, complex and multiplex elements? What are simplest, complex and multiplex elements? 8. So this is the 15 scheme actually. It is not your scheme. 15 scheme. And that time, say 15 scheme has each question having 16. Full question having 16 is there. That's it. Okay, 17 scheme I didn't get. If anyone get it, means share in the group. So we'll see that. This is the question paper about June, July 2019. Let me take next question paper. August, September 2020. Explain briefly node location system and numbering scheme. Node numbering scheme. I told very important, 6 marks. And this is the problem and the minimum potential energy. Anyway, that is not done. Leave it. State and explain convergence requirement. So that's what I told. Compatible condition, convergence criterion, very important. Write a note on geometrical isotropy of 2D Pascal triangle. Just now we discussed, 6 marks. Types of coordinate system, 6 marks. Simplest, complex and multiplex, 6 marks. Next question paper. List the type of element with a neat sketch. 6, 1D, 2D, 3D, what we discussed, that is one. And simply supported by, again, this is a problem that was anyway not covered. List the advantage and disadvantage of FEM. 3 marks. Explains elasticity matrix or D matrix for a stress strain problem. Stress and plane problem. Plane stress problem, no. We discussed about the matrix. D matrix, no. Plane stress and plane strain problem. Can remember that?
Sir. Yes, sir.
That one. Yes, sir, yes, again, sir. Explain simplex, complex and multiplex element. 9 marks. See, that means that you can, by theory itself, you can able to attend one full questions. If you have to attend two full questions, means no need, but you have to cover the problem that will take up at the end, I told. Because it's a somewhat difficulty to explain in the online. That's all. We'll see that. The end. Okay. So next question paper. December 18 and January 2019. Define finite element method. Explain steps involved. I told. Very important question. 10 marks. And one more problem they included. Anyway. Okay. Here also. Explain simplest complement multiplex. See, simplest complement multiplex, how much it is important. I told. That's why convergence criteria, simplest complement. Everything are very important. So that's all about the module 1 questions. Module 1 previous year's question paper questions. And I will send you the assignment. I will upload by today. And I will send you the link to today to join all of you through that class. Okay. Hello.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.